Stars are what precede all the existence of life as we know it, not only in the sense of the sun warming the earth to make life possible, or the constellations guiding humanity to advance civilization, but forging all the elements that make up the world, acting as the furnace of the universe. But how does this forge take place? What are the stars? Where do they come from, and what is their fate? This and much more we will discover now. Welcome to Nebula! First, let's understand what a star is. We can imagine them as large nuclear reactors. A star is constantly radiating energy, and that energy needs to be fueled by something. In this case, it's the process of nuclear fusion. This process is nothing more than the fusion of atomic nuclei whose final product is a new chemical element, and the release of a huge amount of energy. Nuclear fusion in the sun is not a one-step process with two hydrogen atoms coming together to form a helium atom. This process can be broken down into steps that even explain how solar radiation is formed. First, two protons collide because of extreme conditions in the sun's core. Most of the time, the protons don't bond and just go their separate ways, but sometimes one of the protons becomes a neutron, thus forming an atomic nucleus with the other proton and releasing a positron and a neutrino. The name of this atomic nucleus is deuterium. When a third proton collides with deuterium, helium-3 is formed and gamma radiation is released. This radiation comes out of the sun's core and is released as sunlight. Finally, another helium-3 collides with our initial helium-3, forming helium-4 and releasing two protons. These protons, sooner or later, will also collide with other protons and make new nuclear fusions, thus generating a chain reaction. The mass of the helium-4 formed as a final product is less than the masses of the four hydrogen atoms used in the process. This occurs because a part of that mass has been converted to energy and released by the star in the form of light and heat. This is where the energy generated by nuclear fusion comes from, which prevents the star from collapsing. The relationship between the energy generated and the mass used can be obtained by the most famous equation in physics. E equals to m times c squared. In this equation, E represents the energy generated, m the mass that was converted during the process, and c the constant of the speed of light, which is squared. Only 0.71% of the original mass of the four hydrogen atoms is converted to energy, which means little, but we are talking about a process that happens all the time and in absurd amounts, so the energy generated is immense, enough to stop the sun to collapse. A fundamental characteristic of a star is its immense amount of mass, some have more and others less, but always a gigantic mass. It is for this reason that nuclear fusion is important for the star not to collapse, at least not yet. Because of the mass of a star is so large, gravity will always try to compress the star to its smallest possible point, and this intensifies the greater the mass of the star. At this point, the energy released by the nuclear fusion that takes place in the core of the star forces its layers against gravity, thus not letting gravity win, but also not making the star explode, establishing a balance called hydrostatic equilibrium. It is also important to note that the initial mass of the star dictates its lifetime. More massive stars live for several million years, whereas a solar-type star lives in the order of 10 billion years, and also its final fate as a planetary nebula, supernova, or stellar black hole. All objects that have mass have gravity. Knowing this, we can understand how a star is born. The most fundamental structures in the universe, on a cosmic scale, are nebulae, which are nothing more than large clouds made mostly of hydrogen and a little of helium, often called as stellar nurseries. Since everything that has matter has gravity, inside the nebulae, the matter begins to coalesce, until it forms a structure called a protostar. The future of this star would depend on how much mass it will accumulate, and it could even end up being a stellar black hole after its death. Now, let's take a look on the possibilities for the future of a protostar. The simplest object formed in a nebula is the brown dwarf. This object cannot be called a star since it has such a small mass that it cannot undergo nuclear fusion. A brown dwarf can even be compared to the planet Jupiter, but with 13 to 70 times its mass. Brown dwarfs have around 0.075 solar masses. Unlike the planet Jupiter, brown dwarfs can transform a hydrogen atom that has one proton and one neutron, called deuterium, into a tritium, which has one proton and two neutrons, thus releasing some energy that can be detected with certain equipment. An interesting phenomenon occurs with stars that have between 0.075 and 0.5 solar masses. With this amount of matter, nuclear fusion is already possible, but due to the fact that the star has little mass, a counterintuitive phenomenon occurs. Its life will be much longer than that of a supermassive star, and may reach trillions of years, according to estimates. This is because, if the gravity is not so great, the star does nuclear fusion less frequently, so it will take time until all its fuel is used up, which is when a star dies. To give you an idea, the universe is only about 14 billion years old, which means these stars are still at the beginning of their lives. Because of this, it is not known with certainty what will happen to such a star when its fuel runs out, but it is estimated that what will remain will be just a cold rock that does not emit energy, called a black dwarf. When we talk about intermediate mass stars, we enter a more familiar zone, so to speak. These stars have from 0.5 to 10 solar masses, which means that the Sun is in this classification. The life of stars like the Sun usually lasts about 10 billion years, and the Sun is already around 4 billion years old. Here, things start to get interesting. Let's use the Sun as an example to describe your life into the moment of your death. This type of star starts life normally, fusing hydrogen into helium so as not to collapse. When the hydrogen is nearly gone, most of what's left will quickly gather in the star's core, thus making nuclear fusion much faster. This will cause the outer layers of the star to be pushed by the energy of the core, making the star's diameter grow a lot, thus starting a phase that will last about a billion years, the red giant. At this stage, the Sun will get so big that it will swallow Earth and all the planets close to it. When all the hydrogen stock finally runs out, the helium will start to be fused into heavier elements. This will continue until most of the Sun's core is composed only of carbon and oxygen, with a thin layer of helium and an even smaller layer of hydrogen. At this stage, the star will become smaller and bluer. The color of a star indicates its temperature. The blue ones are the hottest and the red ones are less hot. After the star reaches this stage, the Sun will no longer be able to carry out nuclear fusion, so the core will collapse and the star will get bigger and bigger, until it has thrown its outer layers away, forming a planetary nebula. Inside this planetary nebula, only the core of what was once the star will remain. This remnant is called a white dwarf, is about the size of Earth, and can no longer carry out nuclear fusion. A massive star has between 10 and 40 solar masses. Stars of this nature are short-lived compared to the intermediate stars, living for only a few tens of millions of years. This is because they contain a greater mass, the temperature is higher, and nuclear fusions are much more frequent. These stars start by fusing hydrogen into helium, but they can also fuse heavier elements and change it, remaining very large and blue throughout their lives. As it creates heavier elements, they begin to separate into layers in the core, forming layers that produce helium, carbon, oxygen, neon, and silicon. When the star starts to produce iron, its days are already numbered. To fuse iron into heavier elements, the star would have to spend energy. After a significant amount of iron is produced, the star will rapidly collapse and explode within minutes. That's where one of the most magnificent phenomena in the universe happens, the supernova. This explosion is so big and produces so much energy that its light is greater than that of the galaxy in which it's located, being possible to be seen with the naked eye, so much so that in 1054 different civilizations reported having seen a supernova, such as its brightness. This was probably the supernova that created the Crab Nebula, located approximately 6,500 light-years from Earth. Its short, if we can say, distance from Earth contributed to the observations of the supernova. The first supernova studied by astronomers using modern equipment was the SN1987A, located at a distance of 170,000 light-years from Earth, in the Large Magellanic Cloud. Because of its distance, it was not so bright for us compared with the supernova that created the Crab Nebula. It is during a supernova that the other elements in the periodic table are created. Some are also created when two neutron stars or a neutron star and a black hole collide. After the supernova, a neutron star is created, which is only 20 kilometers in diameter, being extremely dense. It is called a neutron star because it was so compressed that the electrons ended up fusing with the protons and forming neutrons. At this stage, the nuclear fusion is no longer possible. When a star has a mass greater than 40 solar masses, the most extreme object in the universe will be formed after its death, the stellar black hole. The life of a star of this caliber is the same as that of a massive star, to fuse elements down to iron and explode in a supernova. It is after the big explosion that it differs. In this case, what remains of the star after the supernova is a point with such great gravity that it ends up being condensed into a point of infinite density called singularity. That's the stellar black hole. The black hole gets its name because its gravity is so strong that not even light can escape it. In the photo taking of the black hole, what can actually be seen was its heavenly horizon, a region where a gigantic amount of mass that has not yet been swallowed by the black hole orbits. If you are enjoying the video so far, we ask you to subscribe to the channel to receive more of our content and explore the universe of science. With that said, we move on to the video. When Carl Sagan said one of his most iconic phrases, "We are made of star stuff," he was referring to the fact that all the elements that make up us were forged in the heart of stars and some of them in their depths. This is why stars precede life. It was in them that everything was first forged, and after their death, just as the organic matter of a living being returns to nature through the action of decomposers, in the nebulae formed by these stars, their matter is bounced back to form new stars and planets. With this reflection, we say goodbye and wait for you in the next video. Thank you for your attention, and may the knowledge guide you.